Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this very special day. A happy Easter to you all. Are you all sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin. We are also sitting in easy chairs, which are better than our school ones, but we are way outside our comfort zone, so do bear with us as we share in this new way of being church together.
We're really grateful to Alan, who's organised all this, and for Mererid, who's leading the worship, and for Charles and Brenda, who are also taking part.
What a way to celebrate Easter. We do hope you are all keeping well and getting enough to eat. It's a worry for everyone and something we could never have expected barely a month ago. Aren't we all so thankful for all those who are working so hard facing many dangers every day as they contend with this deadly virus and provide us for all their needs?
What have you been doing with yourselves? I know for most, we can't go out, we can't go shopping, we can't see friends or family, we can't go to church. So, what can we do? On the television, they were recommending that we try to rediscover some of our old hobbies or try something new. I was thinking I might get back to Family Tree. I remember some lovely Tuesdays with Jackie and John, and they helped us a great deal to get set up. There's still a lot more to do.
We have begun to sort out the garden. I've been busy sowing some seeds indoors and hope to plant them out when they're ready. Who knows what it might look like at the end of all this?
Yeah, it might be a chance perhaps to get into the Bible a bit more. Maybe pray some more. That's easier than it sounds, but do try to give it a go. There's plenty of helps out there to keep you going.
We've been following the Sazara 40 days and quite enjoying it. We've also found the new Jesus film series, thechosen.tv. I think the episodes are really good, and we have, in the week up to Palm Sunday, we actually watched 8 episodes. Do try the website.
Above all, let's remember, Jesus did say to his disciples, in the world, you'll have trouble. But cheer up. I have overcome the world. Because Jesus died on Good Friday and then rose again on this Easter day, we can have new life and can have it more abundantly. Jesus has overcome for all time Satan and sin and death, and now he is alive forevermore. So let's begin the worship now, shall we?
Our first song is Sea Water Morning, otherwise called Resurrection Hymn.
God's salvation plan, wrought in love. A very happy Easter to you all. We're going to read John's account of the first Easter day.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him."
So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes.
But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realise that it was Jesus.
"Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?"
Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him."
Jesus said to her, "Mary."
She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher.
Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God."
Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord."
We're very blessed in our church to have a resident poet, and once again Dorothy has written something for us for today called Easter. A time to indulge, have lots of fun, thinking of all the goodies yet to come. Chocolate eggs filled with Smarties perhaps, and to help them down a glass of Schnapps. Simnel cakes, parades of Easter bonnets, hot cross buns, and a word from Easter sonnets. Bunny rabbits prancing and bounding around, exciting Easter egg hunts without a doubt. But is this really what Easter is all about? Just like Christmas, the true meaning unseen, so few people know what Easter doth mean. Easter's a time of mixed emotions, of tears, unsealing precious lotions, a trial based on false accusation, witness account, misrepresentation, verdict, death on a cross, no hope of reprieve for this innocent man for whom we grieve. He was whipped, spat on, ridiculed for thee, carried his cross that brought him to his knee. Crucified, yet from this cruel cross said, "Father, forgive them," then accepted death. But the amazing fact was, he rose from the grave. All that horrendous suffering for you, for us, bore to save. That was the penalty for our sin and shame. God punished his Son in yours and my name. There was no other good enough, he the only one. He has paved the way, given hope for life to come. Resurrection joy, let us revel in his love until we meet him face to face in his home above.
Join with us as we sing about our Father's love.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his Son, to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain our searing loves, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mother chosen one bring many sons to glory. Sin upon his shoulders, ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gift, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
We now turn to the prayers, which we have split into firstly our nation and secondly the world. We shall leave an opportunity at the end of each for you to add the names and situations you are concerned about before we conclude each section with an Easter acclamation, the second one finishing with a hallelujah, which we hope you can echo in your own homes. Let us pray. Lord, we pray for our nation at this time of urgent need. We thank you for the lovely weather we have had recently, which has dried up the countryside and enables us to appreciate the wild flowers and budding trees. We thank you that we still have some freedoms and pray that these may not be curtailed further. Nevertheless, Lord, we would pray that restricted lives and self-isolation will not cause severe physical and mental problems, leading to broken relationships and hardship. We thank you for the neighbourliness in evidence locally, for the drivers and shoppers. We also thank you for the selfless love shown by volunteers and the medical staff, praying they may be protected from the coronavirus. We ask that those in authority may be given wisdom, and we pray for healing for any who may have COVID-19. In our hearts, we pray especially for Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world.
Let us now pray for that world. Father God, you created this world and it was good, but this virus is spreading throughout it. Please bring it to an end and help us to play our part in that. We thank you that China and Italy are slowly returning to normality. May that continue. But we realise that many people have died. Please bring comfort to those who mourn. And we also realise that, as the virus will probably spread into those poorer parts of the world, the packed streets of India, the isolated villages of Africa with no medical help, please, in some way, bring aid to these communities. We would especially ask that your church will be as active and more so than the virus in these areas. In the silence, we bring to you those known to us personally who are working overseas in these situations. But above all, Lord, we know that you still love the world, and on this Easter day, we thank you for your Son and are reassured by the words many in the world will be saying today. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Well, it's great to be sharing with you on this special Sunday. We know that really every Sunday is there to celebrate the fact that Jesus has come alive from the dead. But isn't it really special on this Easter day to remember that? Our son Peter, who's been so supportive with shopping and things, has called this time house arrest. And that prompted me to think about Paul this morning. The end of Acts 28, we find him after years of travelling, founding churches, sharing the gospel with Jews and non-Jews alike, literally locked in a rented home in Rome, awaiting trial and possible execution. He too was stuck indoors, but we know that he spent his time very profitably. We believe that Philippians and Ephesians and Colossians and Philemon, those letters all came out while he was shut in. Let's look at a couple of verses in one of those letters. I'm going to read from Philippians chapter 1 and verses 22 to 26. Let's start perhaps with 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labour for me. Yet what I choose, I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your joy in Christ Jesus will overflow on account of me. What a dilemma. Things were really very serious for him, with charges brought against him by the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem. Would Caesar call for his execution or set him free to carry on his work? He hoped to be released on what were really trumped-up charges. But with Rome, you never knew. Now, I don't want to be morbid, but like me, I'm sure you have had cause to think the same dilemmas with this deadly virus hanging over us. Look what he said. I know what would be best. I want to die and go to heaven. He used the word depart. Literally, it means loosen. Could mean untying the ropes when breaking camp, or letting go lines when a ship leaves port. Paul was in effect saying, I'd rather pack my bags and go and live with Christ. What a challenge to us in this very comfortable, self-satisfied way of life. Paul was so involved with Jesus that he said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But we can be so caught up with what we would lose that we find it hard to believe what we would gain. In 2 Corinthians 5, Paul follows that illustration through. He says, now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal home in heaven, not built by human hands. Paul, talking about his life, his body, a mere temporary tent, he says, full of struggle, often suffering. At home in the body, he said, but away from the Lord. But Jesus' promise in John 14 about the many rooms. We could be at home with the Lord, complete deliverance from sin and suffering and joy forevermore. But what's the other side of the dilemma? What if I survive, Paul thinks. He thinks he will. There is still so much more to do and much more fruit to be had among the churches. It is probable after release that Paul travelled widely. Maybe he got to Spain, we don't know. He certainly wrote to Timothy and Titus before finally he ended his days recorded in 2 Timothy. It's true with us, really, that we never really know what's ahead. But particularly now, perhaps, what we thought was so predictable, so secure and important has begun to change. Maybe like so many throughout the world, we will need to rethink our priorities, our things, our self-centered way of life. When we get past all this, please God, we will. Is it to go back to things as they were with a deep sigh of relief? Or will it be with a new sense of purpose to be God's people for such a time as this? Certainly the cruel experiences of many during this time have shaken them and us very deeply. May our time of house arrest, with its dilemmas, strengthen our belief in that glorious life to come if our tent pegs are removed. And let's hope a fresh resolve and renewed energy like Paul, if we survive, to spend and be spent in the Master's service. God bless you all.
Let's sing about the Servant King.
And give your life that we might.
Stars into space.